personally and professionally thrilled to have Heidi Maurer from Maastricht University and Professor Hanna Ojanen from Tampere University to come talk to us today about developments in European security defense policy from their national perspectives. Now, Heidi and Hanna are here under the auspices of the Antero Research Program, which is an Erasmus-funded program for teaching, education, and research in EU foreign policy. And they very generously came over yesterday and delivered a spectacular graduate masterclass to the students of UCD and other universities around the country. And today we're asking them to put their public policy hats on and give us a perspective from their national positions on current developments in European security defense policy. And as you know, there's been quite a few developments arising from the new global strategy from Federica Mogherini and a number of new initiatives coming through from the Commission and from the European External Action Service, which are worthy of our consideration and deliberation, and particularly from two countries that have some similarities in respect of European foreign security defense policy, aka Finland and Austria.
So first of all, thank you very much for having me, and special thanks also to Ben for arranging such a nice trip and also such, I think, a stimulating stay for us in Dublin. I'm also really delighted to talk to you a bit about the Austrian perspective on the European security and defense policy. And when I was preparing for this talk, I was really a bit thinking like, okay, when you think about what could Irish people be interested to hear about Austria, of course, the first thing that came to mind was like, probably we'll have to talk about neutrality and how it is perceived in the Austrian context. Nevertheless, I thought in terms of a couple of talking points that I think are useful to talk in terms of the Austrian context are in the end three. So on the one hand, I want to talk a bit of how the definition of neutrality shaped in terms of the interpretation in Austria. I want to talk a bit about, okay, what's the military capacity, what's the role of the military, of defense as seen in Austrian politics. And then last, I want to finish a bit more with what's the political vision and the political will that relates, I think, much more to broader foreign policy making, and then probably we can also talk a bit more about the global strategy. So that was from my side where I thought, okay, that could be interesting in terms of what we want to talk about. The first point on neutrality, I mean, I think we have what you really see when you think about Austrian neutrality in security and defense policy. Very often Ireland comes up as an example too. So very often in the analysis that you read, it's like, oh, we are a bit like the Irish, but a bit different. In the end, neutrality, it's in our constitution, and it's an ingrained part of our neutral politics. What's interesting, I think, when you look at the development over time, that's really something where I think it helps sometimes to take a bit of a bigger time picture, was that, of course, at the beginning, neutrality was very comprehensively defined. It was really, we are neutral. We are not engaging economically, politically, militarily in taking sides in any conflict. So that was really the old Cold War, during the Cold War, the concept of we stay out of it. And that, of course, changed over time, especially in the 80s and the 90s, where you could see that what they called in Austria, we defined it as a differentiated neutrality. So the idea was, well, you know, the world is changing. It's that we, in the end, define neutrality in our constitution in terms of three things. In the end, they are clearly defined also in our constitutional lawmaking. We can't use military force without a UN mandate outside of our borders. So if you want to participate in a UN mission, in a mission, it needs to be under UN mandate. We can't join military alliances. And I will later on talk a bit about how this changed with CFSB. And we can't station foreign forces on our territory. This is still, in the end, what it says in our constitution and where everyone agrees on. What, of course, changed there? We joined sanction policy. We, of course, joined politically different alliances. But this is very clearly defined, okay, a differentiated definition of neutrality about more of a military aspect. What's interesting then is that you really saw when Austria joined the European Union in 1995, so we actually were celebrating 20 years of membership, that many observers said we saw a doublespeak. We saw actually a development of this whole neutrality discourse in two directions. there's the public discourse. We are neutral. And, you know, it's the cornerstone of our foreign policy. It's what keeps us safe, it keeps us sound, and it keeps us prosper, and we are not going to change it. So that's, in the end, the public discourse. And one thing that you also see in the last 10, 15 years very strongly evolving is it's a very emotional discourse. So as soon, even if you have politicians who just want to point out, let's have a very more profound discussion, what does it mean to be neutral as an EU member, they are shut down very quickly by the public reaction in terms of that's not something we're wanting to discuss, we like our neutrality. And that, of course, also harms the discourse. But what was interesting is it also created a second layer of neutrality definition. And that was really like when our government negotiated with the European Union, it's still very much present, that in the end we said, oh yeah, we're neutral, but we also want to actively participate in CFSP. And in the end, it also says in our constitution that while being part of the common foreign and security policy and participating in security arrangements is not in contrast to our neutrality provisions. And that's in the end still what is happening at the moment. The question, of course, is where is the red line? And what I found quite interesting, I was also looking a bit more at the recent documents, especially in terms of military planning, in terms of, okay, what's the future of armed forces, of defense policy in Austria? And when you open the document, and I want to quote here because I found it really interesting, one of the first paragraphs reads as following. The EU is the central framework of Austrian security policy. It is about military service actively engaging and looking forward in cooperation with our European partners. That was one part. But then it goes on, Austrian defense policy rests upon an engaged neutrality politics and the notion of European solidarity. And what I found so interesting when you look at these different documents, you have this public discourse. We are neutral and we can't do anything. But very often, actually, from the expert side, we have this push of saying, no, we have actually to talk and we have to be more active in participating and cooperating. That was the first thing on neutrality. And because I wanted to mention this, because I think we still struggle a bit with this tension. So on the one hand, we have public opinion being very strongly against any touching and discussing of neutrality. At the same time, we have politicians, but also many military experts who are saying, well, we should be much more active. And we should be much more honest in what we mean with defense cooperation. But we should also be much more active in shaping the civilian dimension of European crisis management and crisis operations. And that's also something where many observers are very critical, because very often Austria says, oh, but we mostly participate in the civilian dimension of defense cooperation, of crisis management. But what you then see happening in reality is that they are just labeled as civilian personnel, but actually it's military staff who is engaging in this operation. So you also see there that very often it's a not very honest depiction of what is actually happening on the ground. This whole discussion of neutrality then links together with a second dimension that we see happening in Austria, more generally in foreign policy, and that many people also criticize, and that is really a provincialization and a nationalization of the discourse. So what we really saw happening in the last 10, 15 years is that many discussions that were about what is the role of Austria in the European cooperation in defense and foreign affairs in the international world was then pulled back into a national discourse of, oh, you know, what does Austria want and what's the Austrian interest? And sometimes very local discussions as well. So, for example, when we had a discussion about Austrian security strategy in 2013, the task for our security and defense policy was widened widely. Our military, our defense forces, our security forces should take care of a broad range of security issues, also bringing in a lot of internal security aspects, of course. And I think that's also modern and what's happening in many other countries. But what many people criticized was it was like a catalogue of two pages, and there was no prioritization. There was no talking of, okay, how do we now, in the end, set the focus and link this in the next step with operationalizing, with also creating the means. So what we could see that there's a lot of discussion of what Austrian defense and security policy should be with, but it reads more like a wish list, and it really very quickly just in the end fades away because we don't see that there's a follow-up, especially politically, in terms of what should be the priorities. So very often what we see, it's no prioritization, no resource planning. But we also see a lack of military capacity or just staff capacity in security and defense. So one thing that perhaps I should also mention, in Austria, we still have a conscription army. And in 2013, we had a referendum if we want to get rid of our conscription army and perhaps have a professional army, which also would link to the, in the end, to the expertise that we got of, okay, we want to do more crisis management, we want to do more civil cooperation, so we should have more professional focus, we should have a professional army that can actually participate in that. At the same time, what we saw is, I checked the numbers, that what we had experienced that from in 2000, we still had 3,000 forces, it actually had dropped to 2,000 in 15 years. So we actually had much less military staff, most of them conscription, but at the same time, we had very old structures and very old command structures. So then we always were laughing that actually there are more military people in the command structure than actually on the ground. So in 2013, there was this push by our government, okay, let's talk about this. The problem was, and that comes back to what I meant, it's a nationalization and bringing back the discourse very often away from the security discourse, because the way they had asked in the referendum was, okay, we give you two possibilities, and I will just look that I don't misquote them. But one was, okay, you can have a conscription army and or a civil service that is, in the end, for everyone, male, above 18, or you can have professional army and a voluntary service here where we don't know if these young people are actually then going to support our social sector. So that was the, in the end, we had a referendum with two questions. And the way they had linked it was that the debate in the next 6 months was all about, should we have a voluntary social year or should this be mandatory for those that don't want to go in the conscription army? And I found you could really see it was very frustrating for those who tried to talk about, okay, how can we professionalize, modernize the defense and security services? Because it was all about, okay, what do Austrian people want in terms of social service? As with many referendums, we had a turnout, I think, of 53%. It was mostly elderly people who participated in the referendum. And I think the rate was 63% said, oh no, we keep the conscription army. And what I found very fascinating, you could really see for those who had really worked hard in trying to see, okay, how can we mix, or how can we match our attempt to get a professional, crisis-oriented civil cooperation in our security and defense, at this point really took a blow, because they were saying, you know, we worked so hard in trying to explain to people that this is what we need, and actually, we still don't have the means that we would need to go ahead. And that brings me to my last point that I want to make, because I think when we talk about security and defense policy, of course, it's also linked a bit to the wider political will and the political strategy that we're seeing. And there we see that in Austria we had a very active foreign policy. Despite neutrality, it was always that, okay, we are neutral, but it doesn't mean that we build a wall and pretend there's an outside world. But we want to be the center of mediation. We had a lot of different organizations with a seat in Vienna, and this was really something that was also appreciated and saying, okay, we want to be active in our peace politics. But unfortunately, that did not really last in the last 15 years. So what we really see is, again, a refocus on national issues. And one of the things that, of course, you could see, it also depended very much on internal politics. So, for example, we had a foreign minister who was also the vice chancellor at this time. And he actually declared publicly that I'm not interested in foreign policy. My task is to explain foreign policy to Austrians. And he actually very often did not go to Foreign Affairs Council. We had the same in the Ministry of Defense, where we had defense ministers who had interesting ideas, but they didn't have the expertise and the background that perhaps it would need to push forward their portfolio. And at the moment, what we see, we have a new defense minister since January. He has very interesting ideas, but he comes from the police forces. And he puts a very strong focus on internal security. And again, it fits widely with the wider security and defense focus in terms of, okay, modern security, cyber security. But you also have very traditional things like, oh, we should support border control. We want to, especially at the moment of the refugee crisis, the military should be in charge of managing the border. The military and the security forces should be in charge of emergency management. So especially when we have avalanches in the winter, but also in the summer, we get more and more floodings now. That's really where you see you can also win plus points in the public debate. And that very much shapes at the moment of how Austrian security and defense policy is discussed. I wanted to mention these different things because I think they really show a bit this tension that we're observing in Austrian defense and security policy, and that also reflect a bit of what's happening in how Austria represents itself, I think, in Brussels and in this cooperation network. So on the one hand, there are sometimes attempts to say, okay, we want to more actively talk with partners, especially the non-aligned and the other neutral partners, and saying, okay, what can we actively do in the civil crisis and response, emergency response areas? But that are very individualistic attempts. And what you see that, especially on the political level, the will and the strategic thinking is just not there because mostly they couldn't sell it at home because of our neutrality. One thing that will be interesting, in 2018, Austria is going to hold the presidency. And I was just looking through the plans for the new coalition of what they want to focus on, of course, also with the three presidencies. And one thing, of course, that's very strong and that will remain is proactive engagement in the Western Balkans. So that's also in terms of international crisis management, that's also really something where the Austrians still put a strong focus and also want to remain in Kosovo, in Bosnia, in terms of peacekeeping. A strong discourse on the link between internal and external security, especially cybersecurity, digitalization. And the third item that they said they want to focus on in security terms is cooperation on the external border, on border management. And in the end, I think we're all very familiar with the whole discussion on asylum policy.
I'm really glad to be here and really glad to speak about the contemporary challenges for both Finnish and European defense. For the special reason that for a long time, and now I'm thinking, looking at this from a perspective of a researcher, for a long time the main challenge in the field was how to find something new to say. But now that is no longer the main challenge. A lot is happening and there is no lack of things that we should discuss. Last year, if we take it very shortly, last year in Finland was perhaps a wake-up call of some kind. Otherwise, the other Finnish defense thinking is rather slow-moving. We now also find that it is positive to be slow. But anyway, things are now happening at a different pace. Many things are moving fast. Decisions are being taken. Plans are being prepared. And a big question that I would like to put to us from a sort of European perspective is whether everyone is on the move and whether everyone is moving more or less to the same direction, or whether it is rather that some are moving, others not, and those who move are moving into different directions. Is it that the need to do something that we now so clearly feel, is it that it leads to action nationally rather than on any other European level? Would it be that the European plans look a bit repetitive and slow and lagging behind when compared to the sort of urgency of the situation, some feel? Perhaps the gap between national and European is getting wider. I'll get back to this towards the end of the presentation. But let me first describe to you the main elements of Finnish security and defence thinking, and starting with the big picture of relations with NATO and thinking about the EU. As you know, the basis of Finnish defence has been and is national. It has often been characterised as an independent or and perhaps credible national defence. But what has changed in recent years is that emphasis is more and more on the growing importance of international cooperation for defence. This is new, but it doesn't say that international would somehow replace national. You certainly also know that Finns very much like to debate NATO membership. Finland's relations with NATO are really quite close. They may be closer than those of many member states, one might say. Anyway, the current format these relations take is the NATO Enhanced Opportunity Programme, with many enhanced opportunities, such as pre-approval as a partner to crisis management operations, and participation in the initial phases of NATO's operational training and exercise planning and cyber defence cooperation. So it's more than being a partner, it's being a special partner that can take part in the preparatory stages already. Moreover, both Sweden and Finland have seen their role increase, particularly when NATO has started to look more at the Baltic Sea. And there, a new format has been found that is called the 28+2, which would be NATO members Sweden and Finland. That would be a format that has been used for discussing Baltic Sea regional security issues. A new status, not really, but a nice addendum to this partnership. Of course, limited in space and in time. Anyway, NATO membership remains an option, as we say in Finland. And the most recent debates last year were mainly about the theoretical question of whether Finland and Sweden should join together if they were to join, or what would happen if one of them joined and the other didn't. We had an independent experts group that wrote a report on NATO membership last year, and the general conclusion was that NATO membership was found to be interesting, yes, but very difficult in foreign policy terms. It would mean too big a change in our foreign affairs, and that is relations with Russia. So interestingly, NATO membership was not a question about security and defence, but it was a question about foreign policy. It was also a bit surprising to see that the change in the security of conditions, the security environment, didn't have much. Of course, they had importance. But usually we have always been saying that the only thing that can change the NATO membership discussion in Finland for real is an important change in the security situation in the sort of neighbourhood. Now there is one, but it doesn't change the NATO discussion. So that was a surprise as well. But of course there is awareness of the worsened security situation, and this awareness is very visible also in the government report on Finnish foreign and security policy that came out last summer. It contains an intriguing sentence that I really would like you to continue. It would be lovely to hear what you think it says. It starts with, the primary aim of Finland's foreign and security policy is to avoid becoming a party to a military conflict. I don't think you were expecting that. I wasn't. It's the awareness of the fact that there might be a conflict that we didn't have before. So much for NATO discussion and general security situation. On EU defence, the government was in the report and is positive, but not too detailed. Similarly, our president, Sauli Niinistö, in his New Year's speech, just said, the European Union is needed much more than in decades, but it is now weaker and more fragmented than ever. And he said, the Union's security and defence cooperation has taken a step forward. This is good, he said, and an avenue that must be kept open. So positive, but not too clear. Overall, Finland has always been supportive of EU security and defence policy and of all the security strategies and of the idea of having a security strategy, so also the global strategy of last year. A bit about the expectations that Finland had, perhaps, regarding that strategy. Finland was aiming at seeing a strengthened internal coherence and solidarity in the EU. Also more ambition, perhaps, in the goals on deepening security and defence policy, more conflict prevention, early warning. Finland wanted to make the Arctic one of the priorities. And of course, Russia, what the strategy says about Russia was very important. Finland wanted to see the importance of dialogue there, but also the limits to cooperation if Russia does not respect international law. And I think Finland broadly got what it wanted. There is in the strategy a paragraph on the Arctic, and the strategy is rather clear on Russia as well. Russia is set to challenge the European security order at its core, and the strategy says that managing the relationship with Russia is a key strategic challenge. Yet, it also says Russia and the EU are interdependent, and there are perhaps overlapping interests, and if there are overlapping interests, then there it would be nice to have discussion and cooperation. So the strategy says something about selective engagement in certain areas. Now, the question, of course, is to what extent this strategy is consequential. What about its implementation? It somehow looks like the implementation plan was more an inventory of measures and possibilities that we know from before. The battle groups, the PESCO, the research and industrial cooperation, cooperation with NATO, all this is no doubt fine, but it doesn't seem to prompt any particular enthusiasm or action or policy. They are just there. So not much is happening in that direction, it looks like, seen from the Finnish perspective. But more is happening when it comes to cooperation with Sweden. Their cooperation has been really deepening in the past years in exercises, information exchange, surveillance. And our government's reports on this is very, very generous, saying that this defence cooperation can apply to all situations. It may even include defence of territorial integrity joint use of civilian and military resources, almost anything. But still, there is no plan to have any defence alliance. I think it is too important for both countries to keep their options open and their decision-making unrestricted by any commitment. So a lot of cooperation there that is new. Also, action happening nationally. I think more will be spent in defence in the future. There is a special government report on defence policy that will come out now in February, I guess. And it is expected to lead to discussions about increasing military spending. I don't expect very much opposition. National defence is usually a sort of positively regarded issue in Finland. But there are other changes. There is certainly more, the goal is more clearly higher readiness. You know, we have this large defence force, perhaps the largest in Europe, based on conscription and well-trained reservists. It would be a bit slow for the for this quickly moving world of today. So now high readiness is the goal, and also the possibilities to call the reservists to training with a shorter notice is something that has been discussed and even decided. But what is interesting on a sort of more general level is that the separation between times of peace and crisis is now less clear than before. And also the line between crisis and non-crisis. Our chief of defense just told in an interview that if there was an attack against Finland now, it would start suddenly, it would be full of surprises, it would be difficult to grasp, and one where it becomes difficult to organize a response. So it doesn't sound like the traditional one when we send the soldiers to the forest skiing in a snow-white camouflage, but it is somewhat more surprising. One needs to prepare for the unexpected, and of course hybrid capacities are put at the center. Now Finland is establishing a center on hybrid threats with a number of countries, including the US, many European countries, also the EU and NATO in some form. And this would be a center, like an international organization that focuses on research and training. And it would aim to strengthen the other parties' resistance or resilience and prepare for hybrid threats by training and research, these kinds of activities. So, in all, it looks like when action is needed, and now it is, solutions are first looked at a national level. In Finland, international cooperation is now set to be more important and essential, but the interesting thing is that it isn't the multilateral cooperation that we would first think about. Bilateral cooperation is now overriding both the EU and NATO. And I'm not only speaking about Sweden, but Finland now has bilateral defense-related agreements also with the UK, with the US, and with other neighboring countries. Now it is discussing participation in the joint expeditionary force led by the UK, where Northern European NATO countries participate. And all this looks very attractive to Finland, as it seems to be capacity enhancing in many ways. But I would like to end here, perhaps on a sort of more general note, with a question of whether this bilateralism is a more general tendency that we see today, and what it is in that case that makes bilateralism more attractive than multilateral solutions. It seems it is, but why? Is it simply more reliable, perhaps? It is perhaps easier to calculate, to you know what you get out of it. It's easier to control, more efficient than the multilateral frameworks. Then the question, of course, is what will happen with the EU? The problem might be that the EU does not have much to offer in terms of concrete contribution to national defense or to solving the new, very concrete problems. Or perhaps it has, but it doesn't have the capacity to articulate the ways in which it could be helpful. And this, in turn, impacts on how much a country like Finland actually invests in influencing or in leading or in shaping the EU policies, and how much it prefers being active elsewhere.